He's talking about doing music on a Commodore PET 2001. Take it away, Jim.
Yes, hello. So when I heard this particular class was going to focus on music on Commodore, well, mostly Amiga, but all Commodore line, I remembered I had seen an article in, I think it was one of these publications they did for the user port for the PET series, that you could add on, first of all, add on sound, CB2 sound particularly was the main one, adding a resistor and adding an amplifier, so you could at least get some sound out of your PET, which didn't come with sound. But also, even in 1978, they had a recommendation for adding a digital to analog converter, 8-bit, with a bunch of resistors, a standard, a very fairly simple circuit where you use a resistor ladder and output and do this digital to analog conversion, and then hook that up to an amplifier, and now you get a much, you'd be able to reproduce frequencies along the spectrum and produce much better music. And then someone came up with, well, then an article in Byte magazine from this guy, Hal Chamberlain, who was one of the fathers of sampled music, wrote some code and a circuit design how to do this and play four voices on a Kim-1 or PET, four-voice music.
So, four voices?
Yeah. So,
that's even more than the C64, which is only three voices.
Oh, really? I thought he said it was four. Oh, the Amiga's four. But yeah, you could do all this with this small piece of hardware and some assembly language, you know, some code, very simple code, but it's a very simple type of four voice, as you'll see, with a very, very small sample size, 256 bytes to
Ooh,
be exact.
One. Wow.
So it's extremely small, but it works. It works at least for that era.
Okay, bytes.
Bytes. Yeah, so what I want to go through is show you what the PET music was like when you simply had the CB2 sound, basically. So first, the PET didn't come with any, it didn't come with any sound, so when you added the sound via an amplifier with this simple CB2, one resistor and a wire, very simple, you could do basic sound, like the sounds you've heard I played on, you know, regular video games. But people wrote some music as well, and very simple. So this is the PET jukebox program, and I'll just play a little bit of this. This is your typical CB2 simple sound. One voice, and using simple square wave type of notes. And not always on tune. Okay, so that's what that is. And now I'm going to move into what's called the Petunia software. Now the Petunia, I guess when I could give a little background before I play it. So this circuit diagram was available, through this Byte magazine article and then also through this schematic here. So that was in an old document manual. So I decided, I couldn't find the board itself in the used market. So I decided, hey, I'd like to learn how to use KiCad anyway, a program to design boards. And so I, if you look over here on this screen, you can see the board I designed using KiCad, a board design, circuit board design software that's free. And then here's the finished board that I built. And I had the boards made in China in 1 week for $6 for five of them.
Mm.
And it's quite a deal. And then you buy the parts and you solder it up. And this plugs into the user port and the tape port, external, the second tape port for power. And if I'll show you quickly the, this is the, on this screen here, that's the schematic, and you draw that yourself, and then you go through this whole process, and that's beyond the scope of this meeting, of course, but it's really fun if you're into electronics. You can make your own board for relatively cheaply, and relatively software that most people could learn. It's not rocket science. And just to background that a little more, the article was this one. The article that inspired all of this was by this guy, Hal Chamberlain, called A Sampling of Techniques for Computer Performance and Music in Byte Magazine, 1977. So this was sort of the, you can see something looked very similar to that schematic I just showed you. And 6502 assembly, and then you can see what a sampled sine wave looks like in 8-bit sampling. It's like a little stair-stepped sine wave. And I'll show you, this is the, I printed this out myself. I isolated the sample they used, 256 bytes, that's bytes. And this sample is only 6 milliseconds in time,
wow.
So it's, that's it. So I actually made some of my own samples. I tried and profiled them on a PC, but I had, and I don't know if I'll be able, I couldn't get them to play. Yeah, this is also from the original Hal Chamberlain sample, which I think you'll hear as well. It's an organ sound, essentially, a kind of a complex organ. I made a few of my own that fit in the 256 bytes by using that Audacity software.
Hmm.
But we'll see if I can, those will only play from the cassette tape because of a basic one requirement, and I'm not sure I'll get that to show you that, but we'll show you the Petunia music. The Petunia software is what I found, what that sort of was was sold separately from their board, that the Petunia board very similar to what I've got. And the software let you just play music and even adjust the waveform, which is kind of what I tried to do so far, but we'll see if I can, well, I don't know if we'll be able to see that or hear that today, but they had some good waveforms already, so.
Jim, so you say what you're running is from basic, the basic one version that you have in the PET 2001? It will not run in, I know you have switchable ROMs in there, so it will not, your computer will not run it under basic 2 or basic 4?
Well, okay, there's a few different versions of this software. The one I'll show you right now, it runs under basic 2 and up.
Oh, okay.
Now, there's an older version that will only run on basic 1, which needs to use the cassette.
Oh, okay.
Now, if we have time, I'll show you that. Certain music was done in this era, in this version of the software, like Star Wars. They have a few Star Wars tunes, which are cool. James Bond.
No Star Trek?
Star Wars, yeah. So.
Darn it all, no Star Trek.
No Star Trek. Well, that's an interesting point. And this was the very beginning when the Petunia came out. It was for basic 1. And then later on, someone adapted it to newer, basic 2 and up. And that's the software that I can easily load and play. But to get some of this old stuff relied on the basic one ROMs, which could not use the disk. That's the only bad part. So let me load here. Why is there something else here? So here, with this PET Disk Max, I can conveniently, which uses a micro SD card, I can conveniently load a D64 disk file image, basically, which you can have many files in, of course. And that has the music that I'll show you next. So I guess I should just go for the best one. The best,
sure.
One, the best ones I've found. There's a couple of them actually. But this, out of this group, this one, the Easy Winners, is quite a good song, and it's kind of shows off a lot of the capabilities. Of this particular four voice system.
Now, when you talk about Petunia is that hardware? Is that software?
Yeah, the Petunia was hardware, and then it came with a software as well. I think you had to buy it separately. So the Petunia, briefly started showing it here, but it's hard to find these now, the Petunia. I couldn't find one myself, so that's why I built it, but it had its own manual.
Oh, okay, a manual.
Yeah, it had a manual, okay. And the software is easily obtained, but you need the hardware to use the software. It doesn't do anything without that.
Mm-hmm.
But you can make your own, and this was their original board, looked like that. So mine, it looks similar, but I couldn't find one of these, so I took the opportunity to design a board myself, which is very easy in today's software. And I'll show you more out of that book. So now I've loaded this, and let's start her up. Now this software someone else wrote, which uses the Petunia, it uses the hardware. The code is maybe very similar, but this ended up being an actual editing program that you could edit and add notes and create music with. But in this case, I'll just load and play. So you can tell it's pretty impressive for this 1977 box, right? And that's using this that waveform I showed you. I had to find where it was in machine language or in the monitor. I found where it was and then extracted it and brought it into the PC and then printed it out.
Wow.
Because I wanted to modify it. They said, "Oh, you can modify this wavetable." And so I tried to do that, but it just didn't quite get it to work in time. Unless my last effort works, worked on. But yeah, that's probably, it's either this one or this one. And that's just 256 samples being repeated, stretched or compressed, you know, basically mostly stretched or played faster or slower to get different pitches. And over again at, you know, 4 milliseconds. That's you know, 1,000 times for each 4 seconds.
So when that 256 bytes, it begins and ends the same, so that when it loops, you can't hear it looping.
Right. Now I made one where it was slightly off, and it creates a certain of a crisp sound, and, you know, like a, and so you can get almost a different instrument by changing that. And I could show you. Well, we have time. On the PC, I used the Audacity software and started playing with. You can tell the Audacity software play this particular sample over and over again and then change the pitch. If you want to see that, I'll show that later. So, this program doesn't have a quit.
There you go. Reset.
That's what I have a button for. Oh,
there you go.
Of course, the reset button you had to add too. That was a user add-on. Uh-huh. Everything was a user add-on in this machine. Pretty much everything you use every day.
Run, stop, restore. Does it work in the pet?
Runs. Actually, this program doesn't allow you to quit it. So that usually machine like yeah. So that's their fault. The software's fault.
Not always, if you cancel out the keys, I mean,
yeah, they ignore, oh, well, the PET has the run stop button, but it only really works in BASIC, unless the machine language, if it's all in machine language, they have to look for the key, otherwise, it's just, you know,
right.
Just running, the code's just running, it's not like, I don't care about your user input. Which is really bad programming in today's world, or any really even back then it was very inconvenient. So let's go out of this, and I'll show you another. Actually, I will be able to show you. I think what is other samples besides that waveform, someone else came up with this music software that uses the card.
Okay.
That nobody knew about. It's on like this particular software is online on the 6502 PET software, I think it is, archive.
Huh.
And they didn't realize what it was. They said, this is something about music, but it may require a new ROM or something, and they didn't know. And so I wonder if that, it doesn't play out of the regular speaker, regular CB2. So I loaded it up, and it played.
All right.
The new hardware.
You discovered a
yeah.
A,
or it's,
a
so it's like an archaeological dig.
Hello.
Oh, hi.
Hi guys.
Ah, and this one's called Sound-1-EK.
Sound-1-EK. What? Okay.
Yeah, it's a. Again, you know, this is the meanings of these things are lost to the. To time.
To time.
Yeah. I'm sure someone knew what it was at some point.
Okay.
And, oh, shoot. So it's also a D64 disk.
Okay.
So I'll load this up.
Thank you.
So this has a lot of music.
All right, that's what we need, more music.
Yeah, I mean, all written in four voice for this particular.
Four voices, unbelievable.
Yeah, so I went through all these songs looking for the best, just for this event, really.
Oh, wow, thank you very much.
And so, yeah, it's, there's a lot of stuff there, but you know, only very little of it is really the best. But yeah, actually, you can go right to one of these that really shows off, I think, different samples. And that's like this Nutcracker stuff.
Okay.
And reed flutes, candy, fairy, Nutcracker. And then I can show. So the other ones above it sound fairly similar to what you heard, that kind of organ sound.
Okay.
But these, I'm pretty sure, I can't 100% confirm, but I really believe that they changed the waveform.
Mm.
And they're using, I think they're using multiple waveforms for different notes. Because there's no reason, you couldn't have two of 56 tables and use both different waveforms for different notes if you wanted to. Let's reset. talking and trying to use an old PET are a little bit difficult. We make one mistake and more work. Here with me.
Error in zero. Oh no.
Oh, I'm sorry. I have to load in this case, you had to load two things. You have to load a program and then the music.
Oh, okay. Got it. A loader program.
Yeah, and of course this one's called the new music.
New music.
I'll show you the old music.
new music
if
from
you're still interested.
1980 or so. There you go.
Yeah, by new meaning it's like they changed the machine language and I think added the multiple.
Oh, okay.
The multiple samples, perhaps in this case. It's not 100% clear, but whoops. What's the insert? Oh, it's not working. Why is it coming back? Oh, well. /.
Okay.
Let's see. And this has to convert a bunch of data.
Oh.
I thought this was very funky. Notice the very low bass.
Yes, it is. If we had Richard's clip speakers from yesterday, it would be pumping out the bass.
That's right. Notice the difference. It doesn't sound like an organ. Is that?
Yes, sir. We had a subwoofer connected to
us before. Oh, yeah. It's almost funny. Yeah, you know, almost laugh. It's almost tongue in cheek.
Hey, we should record that and drop it into one of our class videos, class commercial videos. There you go.
And let me show you. There's a few other ones that are.
Oh, look
see,
at
that other one
doing
was
some system calls. Let's see that.
Yeah, that's all machine language.
Huh, interesting.
That's the new music one, and there was the original. Show you, it's more of like the same of the organ. But now this is Candy Fairy.
He's going down for the
Candy Fairy.
Which is also from Nutcracker.
Okay.
But it also has a cool sound for something this old. It's really quite remarkable.
How does it coordinate like the different multiple notes at the same time? Is each one its own separate like series of notes and then it plays them together?
Yeah, well, it's essentially. Yeah, this sounds cool. This because of the DAC, the digital analog converter. That's why. And yeah, the whole, I can turn this down and talk.
No problem.
It is pleasant to listen to
some
of these music, but the way it works is it works from those waveform samples, right? Now you have the four voices, and simply it simply does is add them together and create a more complex wave is what's happening. So in the machine language, you've got the four voices, you've got the four sets of notes as well, and then up to four, of course not always. And then what it does is it's taking that same sample or maybe another sample, and it's adding that to the final output value, and that gets sent to the DAC. So if you looked at this in an oscilloscope, you'd see, if it's playing one note, you'd see that wave. If it's playing two or three or four notes, you'd now see the wave modulated by the other notes on the waveform, so you see a complex waveform.
Huh.
So it's all done in software, yeah.
Interesting.
So the four voices just like an arbitrary limit. They figure that's as many as we can process.
That's as many as we can. Now, well, here's the key factor. If you notice, or actually you may not notice on this, but in order for this to work, the voices must add up and not exceed 255, 0 to 255. That means each voice can go 0 to 63. If you went to zero, if you wanted to go much lower than that, like 0 to 31, to double it to eight voices, you're not going to have much resolution in those. You'll be able to barely. So I had to take the wave that were in my sample and I wrote a Python script that took the wave I generated from PC software and reduced it down to 0 to 63 in order. And this is explained, by the way, in Hal Chamberlain's article and the Petunia article manual, that you can, you can change the sample, just go to 0 to 63.
And these articles are easily found online, or did you have to really dig to try and discover these?
Well, that's the other thing. No, that one was instant. The Internet Archive has that byte article,
okay.
And the Petunia manual is online. I can send it. It's like sending the URL. Nope. And the Petunia manual explains a little bit and then tells you, go check out the Hal Chamberlain article from 1977 byte. Now, there was another, I guess, moving up to the sort of the culmination of all this in software-wise was the Visible Music Monitor, another piece of software that nobody knew exactly. How do you use this?
Visible Music Monitor.
And this was made for the PET as well, around 1980, it says.
Okay.
So this is pretty well before, and this was designed to use the 8-bit DAC or Petunia.
Oh, wow.
And you could do, you could see it's got a graphical display of notes and everything that you could tediously enter in, okay?
tediously, let's say.
It is true. I guess you could use the keyboard to play notes. With this software, is a little better than the original Petunia software. Was literally you enter D, then four, and then for a four beat D, and that's terrible. But this was, I think, a little better, where you could actually have a keyboard and it would record. I haven't learned how to use this software, but there's a lot to it. But what I can do is load it and play what it has as its sample. But before that, I'll show you one of the regular old music on this disc, which let's go back to the directory.
Old music.
Yeah. So this was some like I said, unnamed software that somebody sort of adapted. For the 8-bit output, right? And so then they had two versions. The one you heard there was the newer, sort of better. But the old one was similar to the music I played for you earlier from the Petunia, actually. So this was some derivative that came after the Petunia. And I think, let's see, what was the best one of that? Oh, 76 trombones is kind of fun.
Okay.
So let's play that one.
76 trombones from the Music Man?
Is that right?
I believe so.
Oops. Load. 76. And what's interesting is everybody loved to put exclamation point after file names. I don't know if that came into the D64 as well, but it seems like the PET, they love doing that. Notice this started right away because this is a different machine language program. And this is, you can probably hear, that's the same type of organ sample. Slightly different, maybe. So yeah, for 63 values and a 256 byte sample in a 4-way, you can do it. Different low and high tones. Anyway, now let's try to load that VMM.
Oh yeah, the Visual Music Monitor.
Yes, monitor. That's it's a pretty big. Actually, I don't know if I might need to switch to 32. Or I am in 32K. I don't know. I might have to reset for that. Whenever you got machine language running, you never know if you're going to be able to run another one without rebooting. VMM. Let's try that. Also with these PETs, the more you use them, the keyboard comes back to life because they sit in a garage a while, you're not able to use the certain keys won't press.
Right. I didn't know you had to exercise the keys.
Yeah, these are the chiclet calculator keys. Oh, maybe I'm in the wrong directory. Gotta go dot dot. This archaic syntax for loading directories. Okay, so this is a pretty advanced software.
Huh.
You can even edit the waveforms. With this here, you could add, change, delete. And I showed you the waveforms in some sort of weird thing, but it's quite kind of bizarre. It is documented though, how to use it, I guess.
So that's the loader.
This was just, I just went into this waveform editor. But this is the main program.
Okay, can you hold it there for a little bit? So it says, clear segment, keyboard, master, play music and tape,
music, keyboard.
Save, program, and waveform. Huh.
Right, so they did all that. Now, let's try the keyboard. That's something I haven't even done myself.
You mean play live?
Yeah, let's see if it... See if that works, actually. Let's try number 3.
Play music live from your PET.
I don't know. Or it might just be for entering music.
Oh, okay.
I think, it's a note scale here. And, entering notes. End of chord, end of bar, rest, space, change, next voice. So again, you could use multiple, that's the multiple voices. not sure about the sample.
Oh, okay, so it's just for keyboard input, it's not for playing live music.
You may wish to record
music.
Your method of key representation. I'm not sure if it... Now, I have other software that plays live using the CB2 music.
Oh,
which
using
is just
CB2.
The, yeah, not this one, though.
Ah, darn it all.
Oh, I know what the answer is. See, CB2 is interesting. CB2 uses a shift register, okay? And it uses the VIO or the IO chip in there, okay? And that one could work independently from the CPU. So that's how why you can play music, or you can play sounds during your video game actually simultaneously, because the IO chip is feeding it out of its it's running a loop in hardware even on this PET. And once you set it up and give it a you know, some bytes, it then shifts out the those bytes repeatedly, and those bits go out to the speaker, and that's all being done independently of the CPU. So then the CPU can run your game.
Okay,
that's how that worked. With this whole DAC thing, it takes 100% of the CPU to play music. So no going, no CB2, and no parallel ability to play music. So let me get out of this here. Actually, I don't even... How do you get out of this?
Reset.
Yeah, I could just do reset. There is a... So let me just play that. It's quick to reset, and then what's nice about the this PET Disc Max, or any of those other ones, they stay where they are. The directory stays the same, and you can just look... you can just use it because it doesn't shut off when you reset.
Oh, okay.
So here's an example of what they you could do in this. So this takes, yes, 100% of the CPU.
Okay.
To play.
Okay. Whereas the live music one that you were talking about is only one bit.
That's one voice, and it's using CB2 instead of the DAC, instead of all the I/O lines of the user port.
And do you have the one bit live player there on your computer?
Yeah, I can show you that.
All right, live music.
I practiced a little, but I'm not very good at this.
Okay. Well, we're happy with anything.
So don't expect. Yeah.
That's okay. No problem.
So return to basic, and then...
expect a full concert.
A full concert?
Yeah.
Seth Sternberger from 8-Bit Whippet, you played live music. Hey, look at this, a pet.
With some practice, you could get reasonably, do something, like a little quick tune, like Mary Had a Little Lamb.
Oh,
that's
God.
About the level we're talking here.
On the Chiclet keyboard? Ooh.
Yeah, you can do it. this one's called, let's see, there's a couple of them. Rhino Key is a decent one, and then there's Compose Music is the other one. I guess I can show both of those. Let's start with Rhino Key.
Huh.
Yeah,
what a name.
I don't know where they got the name exactly. So there you go. Load that. Run.
Oh. What am I looking at there?
Yeah. You can't play multiple notes.
Yeah.
Well, there you go. You can just do them like that.
Ooh.
It's hard to find the key.
You are doing very well on that chiclet keyboard. What did it do? It went into the keyboard buffer?
Oh, I did a play. So you can record all this.
What? Yeah, it'll record a number of keystrokes?
And then you can play it at different speeds.
Oh.
And you can, of course, loop it.
Oh, it loops? There you go.
Yeah, so this is a nice little key where you could eventually play. Oh, there's that one other, and this was developed in 2020, by the way, Rhino keyboard.
Wait, Rhino keyboard is a brand new program for 2020?
Yeah, that one's new for this
guy, Mark. Wow, amazing.
I forgot to say, there's also, or it was on my list as well, is the PET synth. You might have heard of the PET synth.
Yeah, I've heard of it.
So I can show that briefly too, because that one's...
When did that come out?
That one's not that old either.
Yeah, I know. That's a name that I've heard of it, but... I mean, I've heard of the name.
It's a PET... Why do I have it wrong? PET synth.
The name...
I don't know where it is. That's PET synth 07, or I think it's 07. Let's see, list. Yeah, PET synth 007. That one actually has effects that they did. Oh, wait, yeah, I better...
Effects? You mean sound effects?
Right. Oh. Now, before we finish, don't let me forget the latest. We're going to go back to 1-bit music and a modern composer from this year, last year.
Oh, and, modern.
Oh, and then there's the Attack of the PETSCII Robots. I can show that.
Yeah.
It's kind of snowy on this machine, but
okay.
It...
Yeah, we don't care. We don't care.
So PETSCII.
PETSCII.
By this guy. This is 2008, 2009, so
okay.
It's not very new.
Well, it's still newer than the 1980s.
Rock on.
Rock on.
What's that?
Rock on, man. Rock on.
So this is 1-bit sound with some effects on it.
Huh. 1-bit sound with effects.
Yeah, they're... They're doing various things to the wave, to the way it's being generated, essentially, to do distortions and things.
Oh.
At least what you can do with 1-bit.
Yeah.
Playing this is really difficult, but there, a guy on YouTube took this software, and he's like a professional, at least a good musician, and he hooked this up to his better equipment, and he used it as a source, anyway.
Huh.
So
interesting.
That's PETSCII.
Okay.
The other one is called Compose Music. I'm not sure if that one's worth looking at. I think that's that might be pretty similar to the other one we just saw. Let's check it out. Is that the right name? Yeah, this one was kind of earlier.
Compose, okay.
Yeah, this was not, this was a vintage compose
okay.
music.
Vintage.
Oh, and I think it was made in Britain because it spells program with an E
okay.
and two M's. So, you could load a song from tape,
load,
save a song,
compose
a song.
Here, save, add to your song, huh?
Yeah, so here, this
whoa.
Had an actual keyboard.
Yeah, it was a keyboard. Or at least a graphical representation.
Oh, and here you could do a length of notes and hit space to stop them, so.
Huh. That's interesting.
Mm-hmm.
So it'll hold that note until you press space.
You press space, and then it can record all this. Press star to finish, for instance.
I wonder how long it. I mean,
hear your song.
I wonder how much memory it has to record a song.
Yeah. Well, maybe it. Yeah, whatever it has, I guess. Oops, too much. I mean, you know, 16K or brace yourself. So it can play back what I was doing.
Oh. Look, you hit the stopper.
Yeah, that's the thing with music in this case. Phew, thank goodness. It's got some humor in here that it knows you're probably not a master musician.
Oh, good thinking.
Good thinking for quitting.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, he kind of knows, you know, you're not necessarily the best musician, but...
Oh, okay. Oh, those British...
Well, you might be good.
It's that British humor. There you go.
Could be. Okay, so now, this is important. The for the Back to the 1-bit world in a modern take. So you heard the initial 1-bit music.
Yes.
And you heard the nice 4-voice music. The best that is available for this machine. And now we're going to go through, or we're going to hear... the kind of the best that's ever been done, I think, with 1-bit music and new code by this guy who he submitted his music for publication in the Attack of the PETSCII.
Oh, okay.
But it wasn't accepted because there's tons of people, I guess, doing that.
I don't know.
From what he said. So, there's a couple good songs
it's
here.
So, some kind of player here?
He's a musician and a 6502 assembly language programmer.
Oh,
combined.
Okay.
That's why this became possible.
Look at that.
So, listen to this. This is what you can do if you're a good musician with 1-bit.
With 1-bit.
And notice the screen is active. This is CB2 sound because you can still use the screen. It's not taking the whole CPU.
Great.
Oh, and this one, number 1, 2, 7, and 8 are kind of good. So that's what that sounds like.
And
it's got a good beat.
Is there a year on? I'm sorry.
2021,
wow.
So number 2 is pretty good.
Oh.
Now this, I'm sure this pales to anything that Commodore 64 can do, but... For 1-bit, not bad.
Hey, but when you throw that your DAC on there, that DAC could possibly give competition to the SID.
That's amazing if you think about it. You know, 1978 they were doing this, and I can I have Star Wars tunes I can load from tape, but it's almost not worth waiting for for you guys. For me, that's.
How long does it take to load from tape?
It's like 5 minutes. You know, Well, you wouldn't do it on camera, but
right.
Yeah, I could load it off camera and then play it.
Of course. Editing can be done.
So this is pretty good.
Okay.
That's Bosstown Dynamics.
Bosstown Dynamics.
And here, number 8 is pretty good as well. And if you want to see the
what was the song?
Oh, no, hot buttered popcorn. Hey, all this could be background music for our next class commercial. I just need a recording. I could drop it into the video. There you go.
So the attack of the PETSCII robots, I'm going to show you just a second of that.
Okay.
On the PET, because you were sort of... in fact, well, the thing about PETSCII robots is it was, if you read about it, he made it for the PET, his first version was for the PET.
Okay, I didn't know it was originally for the PET. I thought it was originally for the C64.
Yeah, then he moved it to all his other ones.
Right, to all his other platforms.
Yeah, including the 64, but it was originally for the PET, and he says that. I didn't know until I read it, but then he adapted it. So for pet owners, it really is, made for the pet, an original. And yeah, it's kind of interesting that people are making stuff for.
Right.
Because you've just seen a 2021, a 2020. This one is also.
Yeah, Attack of the PETSCII Robots.
Last year, I think.
Yeah, 21 or 22. Yeah. 2021, 2022. Yep, brand new stuff.
It's a lot of work too, because this is quite a. Why is it doing that? I've never seen this. Zero. Let's see. Oh wait, is it loaded? Will they make the directory or not? Okay. Let's see, load. Pet robots. On the 8.
Shareware.
Yeah, so I have the shareware. I did not purchase the game, at least not yet, because it runs so snowy on this computer.
Oh, okay.
I don't know. It made for C64 VIC 20 and PET version. So it comes with its own 1-bit music. And it actually loads from disk different files. And so now this is what it looks like essentially on my...
Oh, there it is. That is Attack of the PETSCII Robots. The door opens.
There is some sound.
Yeah. Oh yeah, okay, it runs well. There you go.
The main problem is the snow, and
right,
I actually emailed the author about that, just to ask him if he knew of any way to improve that on the old pets. But he said that he does refreshes at like almost 30 times a second, so on the old pets you couldn't do that.
Did you try to run it under emulation to see if it does the same?
Under emulation on the device?
The PET.
Yeah, I don't think it does, because this snow is a hardware issue.
Hardware.
And it even does it on the external screen, too, so it's on the video signal. Because I can turn, if I plug in my external screen, it was also doing this. It's part of the video hardware limitations, which doesn't happen in later packs. So you can see the map here. This is one of the most advanced games, probably for this pet that works on this.
Uh-huh.
All right, well, thank you. That concludes.
Thank you, Jim. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
The Commodore Los Angeles Super Show.